Harper Audio presents Pharaoh by Wilbur Smith, read by Mike Grady. Although I would rather have swallowed my own sword than openly admit it, deep in my heart I knew that finally it was over. 50 years ago the Hyksos multitudes had appeared without warning within the borders of our very Egypt, out of the eastern wilderness. They were a savage and cruel people with no redeeming features. They had one asset that made them invincible in battle. This was the horse and chariot, which we Egyptians had never seen or heard of previously, and which we looked upon as something vile and abhorrent. We attempted to meet the Hyksos onslaught on foot, but they swept us before them, circling us effortlessly in their chariots and showering us with their arrows. We had no alternative but to take to our boats and fly before them, southward up the mighty Nile River, dragging our craft over the cataracts and into the wilderness. There we lingered for over 10 years, pining for our homeland. Fortuitously, I had managed to capture a large number of the enemy horses and spirit them away with us. I soon discovered that the horse, far from being abhorrent, is the most intelligent and tractable of all animals. I developed my own version of the chariot, which was lighter, faster, and more manoeuvrable than the Hyksos version. I taught the lad who was later to become Tammuz, the Pharaoh of Egypt, to be an expert charioteer. At the appropriate time, we Egyptians swept down the Nile in our fleet of riverboats, landed our chariots on the shores of our very Egypt, and fell upon our enemies, driving them into the northern delta. Over the decades that followed, we had been locked in the struggle with our Hyksos enemies. But now, the wheel had turned full circle. Pharaoh Tammuz was an old man, lying in his tent, mortally wounded by a Hyksos arrow. The Egyptian army was melting away, and tomorrow I would be faced by the inevitable. Even my intrepid spirit, which had been vital in carrying Egypt forward over the past half century of struggle, was no longer sufficient. In the last year, we had been beaten in 2 successive great battles, both bitter and bloody, but in vain. The Hyksos invaders, who had seized the greater part of our fatherland from us, were on the threshold of their final triumph. The whole of Egypt was almost within their grasp. Our legions were broken and beaten. No matter how desperately I attempted to rally them and urge them onwards, it seemed that they had resigned themselves to defeat and ignominy. More than half of our horses were down, while those still standing were barely able to bear the weight of a man or chariot. As for the men, almost half of them bore fresh and open wounds that they had bound up with rags. Their numbers had been reduced by almost 3,000 during those 2 battles that we had fought and lost since the beginning of the year. Most of the survivors staggered or limped into the fray with a sword in one hand and a crutch in the other. It is true that this shortfall in our roster was caused more by the desertion than by death or wounding in the field. The once proud legions of Pharaoh had finally lost heart, and they fled before the enemy in their multitudes. Tears of shame ran down my cheeks as I pleaded with them and threatened them with flogging, death, and dishonor as they streamed past me on their way to the rear. They took no heed of me, would not even glance in my direction, as they threw down their weapons and hurried or limped away. The Hyksos multitudes were gathered before the very gates of Luxor, and on the morrow I would lead what would almost certainly be our last feeble chance to avert bloody annihilation. As night fell over the field of battle, I had my manservants clean the fresh bloodstains from my shield and my armor, and beat out the dent in my helmet, which earlier in the day had deflected a Hyksos blade. The plume was missing, sheared off by the same enemy blow. Then, by the flickering flame of a torch and the reflection in my polished bronzed hand mirror, I contemplated my own image. As always, it gave my sorry spirits a lift. Once again I was reminded how readily men will follow an image or a reputation when common sense warned of imminent annihilation. I forced a smile into the mirror, trying to ignore the melancholy shadows in the depths of my eyes. Then I stooped out under the flap of my tent and went to pay my respects to my well-beloved Pharaoh. Pharaoh Tammuz lay on his litter, attended by three of his surgeons and six of his numerous sons. In a wide circle around him were gathered his generals and high counselors, and five of his favorite wives. All of them wore solemn expressions, and his consorts were weeping, for Pharaoh was dying. Earlier in the day he had received a grievous wound on the field of battle. The shaft of the Hyksos arrow still protruded from between his ribs. None of his physicians present, including even me, the most skilled of them all, had had the temerity to attempt to withdraw the barbed arrowhead from so near to his heart. We had merely snapped off the shaft close to the lip of the wound, and now we awaited the inevitable outcome. Before noon on the morrow, Pharaoh would almost certainly have vacated the golden throne in favor of Utteric Turo, his eldest son, who was sitting by his side, trying not to make it too obvious that he was relishing the moment when the sovereignty of this very Egypt would pass to him. Utteric was a vapid and ineffectual youth, who could not even imagine that by the settling of tomorrow's sun his empire might no longer exist. Or rather, that was what I believed of him at that time. I was soon to learn how sadly I had erred in judging him. By now Tammuz was an old man. I knew his age almost to the hour, for it was I who had delivered him as an infant into this harsh world. It was popular legend that his first act on arriving had been to piss copiously upon me. I suppressed a smile as I thought how over the ensuing 60-odd years he had never hesitated to make even his mildest disapproval of me manifest in the same manner. Now I went to him where he lay and knelt to kiss his hands. Pharaoh appeared even older than his actual years. Although he had recently taken to dyeing his hair and beard, I knew that beneath the bright ginger pigmentation he favored, it was actually white as sun-bleached seaweed. The skin of his face was deeply wrinkled and speckled with dark sunspots. There were bags of puckered skin beneath his eyes, eyes wherein the signs of approaching death were all too obvious. I have not the faintest idea of my own age. However, I am considerably older than Pharaoh, but in my appearance I seem much less than half his age. This is because I am a long liver and blessed by the gods, most particularly by the goddess Inanna. This is the secret name of the goddess Artemis. Pharaoh looked up at me, and he spoke with pain and difficulty, his voice husky and his breathing wheezing and labored. Taita, he greeted me with the pet name he had given me when he was but a child. I knew that you would come. You always know when I need you most. Tell me, my dear old friend, what of the morrow? Tomorrow belongs to you and Egypt, my lord king. I know not why I chose these words to reply to him, when it was a certainty that all our tomorrows now belonged to Anubis, the god of the cemeteries and the underworld. However, I loved my Pharaoh, and I wanted him to die as peacefully as was possible. He smiled and said no more, but reached out with a hand that shook and fingers that trembled, and took my own hand and held it to his chest until he fell asleep. The surgeons and his sons left his pavilion, and I swear I saw a faint smile cross Utteric's lips as he sauntered out. I sat with Tammuz until well after midnight, the same way I had sat with his mother at her parting. But finally the numbing fatigue of the day's battle overwhelmed me. I freed my hand from his and leaving him still smiling, I staggered to my own mattress and fell upon it in a death-like sleep. My servants woke me before the first light had touched the dawn skies with gold. I dressed for battle with all haste and belted on my sword. Then I hurried back to the royal pavilion. When I knelt once more at Pharaoh's bedside, he was smiling still, but his hands were cool to my touch, and he was dead. "I will mourn for you later, my mem," I promised him as I rose again to my feet. "But now I must go and try once more to make good my oath to you and to our very Egypt." It is the curse of being a long liver to survive all of those whom you love the best. The remainder of our shattered legions were assembled in the neck of the pass before the golden city of Luxor, where we had been holding the ravening hordes of the Hyksos at bay for the past 35 desperate days. In review, I drove my war chariot along their decimated ranks, and, as they recognized me, those who were still able to do so staggered to their feet. They stooped to drag their wounded comrades upright and to stand with them in their battle formations. Then all of them, men who were still hale and strong together, with those who were more than halfway to their deaths, raised their weapons to the dawn sky and cheered me as I passed. A rhythmic chant went up. "Taita! Taita! Taita!" I choked back my tears to see these brave sons of Egypt in such desperate straits. I forced a smile to my lips and laughed and shouted encouragements back at them, calling to those stalwarts in the throng whom I knew so well. "Hey there, Osman! I knew I would find you still in the front rank. Never more than a sword's length behind you, my lord," he shouted back at me. "Luthan, you greedy old lion, have you not already hacked down more than your fair share of Hyksos dogs?" "Aye, but only half as many as you have, Lord Tata." Luthan was one of my especial favourites, so I allowed him the use of my pet name. When I had passed, the cheering dropped into a dreadful silence once more, and they sank to their knees again and looked down the pass to where they knew the Hyksos legions were waiting only for the full light of dawn to renew their assault. The battleground around us was strewn thickly with the dead of the many long days of slaughter. The faint pre-dawn breeze bore the stench of death to where we waited. With each breath I drew, it clung as thick as oil to my tongue and the back of my throat. I hawked and spat it over the side of my chariot, but with every subsequent breath it seemed to grow stronger and more repellent. The carrion eaters were already feasting on the piles of corpses that were scattered around us. The vultures and the crows hovered over the field on wide pinions and then dropped to the ground to compete with the jackals and hyenas in the shrieking and struggling mass, ripping at the rotting human flesh, tearing off lumps and tatters of it, and swallowing them whole. I felt my own skin crawl with horror as I imagined the same end awaiting me when finally I succumbed to the Hyksos blades. I shuddered and tried to put these thoughts aside as I shouted to my captains to send their archers forward to retrieve as many of the spent arrows from the corpses as they could find to refill their depleted quivers. Then above the cacophony of squabbling birds and animals, I heard the beat of a single drum echoing up the pass. My men heard it also. The sergeants bellowed orders, and the archers hurried back from the field with the arrows they had salvaged. The men in the waiting ranks came to their feet and formed up shoulder to shoulder with their shields overlapping. The blades of their swords and the heads of their spears were chipped and blunted with hard use, but still they presented them towards the enemy. The limbs of their bows had been bound up with twine, where the wood had cracked and many of the arrows they had retrieved from the battlefields were missing their fletchings. But they would still fly true enough to do the business at point-blank range. My men were veterans, and they knew all the tricks for getting the very best out of damaged weapons and equipment. In the distant mouth of the pass, the enemy masses began to appear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.